completely disorganized. That would be really good.
Wait, how do you do that?
I'm a huge fan of Oasis.
I think it's pointless.
It's like a really good opportunity to actually get weird. Like, it's kind of my...
Come on, guys.
I'm being very reductive here.
No, I don't get it.
Oh, you're just following trends.
I think more and more people can become web designers now because of these amount of tools that we have at our disposal. Obviously, you know, AI has become a piece of that. But even just the tools we have in terms of like component libraries or UI kits, the amount of plugins within Figma, just there is more and more and more, which is great in a lot of sense, because as business owners as well, you know, we aren't just freelancers. We can now do so much more as one person, which to me is someone who's always kind of felt more aligned with that solo path. Is very exciting and very inspiring.
With the whole rise of the AI element, you know, being able to create artwork with a prompt, a lot of the Figma plugins, which is like, you know, again, AI driven, which makes it really easy to make things, which kind of basically gives the designer more time.
And then you get the problem of things like AI. You can type in a website address and it will create a site for you based on that, the style or the aesthetic of, you know, stuffandnonsense.co.uk. That's what creates trends, because it's just this kind of unthinking mass of people all moving in one direction, you know, with the guardrails on.
Almost coming, like now I'm even seeing the trend within Webflow that a lot of sites look very similar. Lots of animations, lots of rounded edges, lots of like, you know, SaaS companies and things like that. And it was very exciting when I first started doing it. I was so inspired by that style. I was like, oh, everything is so clean and it's so sleek. And even down to the way that the copy was put was just very minimal and intentional, and I loved it.
Bento UI, again, something Apple uses a lot, but I just feel like I've seen too much.
And just like anything with a trend, after enough time, now I'm like, oh, that's the last thing I want. I want something that feels so human and has really that more personal touch to it. I think it's kind of like the antithesis of what AI is doing to our design style, is I'm craving something that feels very real, that is made by human hands. Even if AI is behind it, you know, in the workflow, which it certainly is for me a little bit.
I'm Japanese, and Wabi-sabi is basically a philosophy of like imperfections and celebrating the, you know, the human touch, the nature, the whole, you know, whole of the things that the machine can't achieve. So bringing that philosophy, the wabi-sabi philosophy, into the digital space, I feel like there is something in there. So not just aesthetics, you know, but also functionality as well. Embracing the imperfections, you know, introducing organic elements, hand-drawn illustrations, natural textures, adding those kind of, you know, authenticity to it.
I hope that the work that I do demonstrates that things can be done differently. And not different for different sake. You know, you don't move a search box just because you think it'd be cool to stick it 4,000 pixels down the bottom of the screen. That would be stupid. But, you know, different in terms of the fact that it's thoughtful.
I love just all of the software and the tools that are being created. And, you know, even Envato was a very early piece of my design career, and being like, I remember I was working at an agency, and I was the youngest one there, was the new intern that was just hired, and most of my bosses and whatnot were probably had about 10 years on me. And I had just discovered like mock-up templates, and I brought them in, and we were using it for all of our clients, and I came up and I was like, well, what if we presented it like this and just did it, you know, in 20 minutes? They were all blown away of like, wait, how'd you do that?
This video is brought to you by Envato, the unlimited creative subscription. Find and download authentic graphics, templates, photos, and fonts. Follow the link in the description and start creating now.
I think there is a big rise of 3D, you know, like designer-friendly 3D tools, like, you know, 3JS, Spline. Motion is kind of becoming really easy to, you know, create and arrive. DSAP, Lottie, that's kind of been around for a little bit. And I think that kind of leads to a little bit of a risk of being a little bit safe, generic, cookie kind of design because of all of that
don't get me wrong, I'm a big believer in, you know, in motion in general. When you overuse it, that's when I think problems start to appear. It gives me a headache. I don't think it's a good approach.
I see a lot of websites and a lot of the company uses extensive use of animation just for the sake of making it kind of exciting, but with no purpose.
I'm a big fan of brutalism, both in terms of architecture and websites. And then you've got, on the other hand, you've got, especially with things like WordPress and block themes and the stuff that's happening around there, you've got like a lot of minimalist design going on at the moment. Again, you could argue those are quite separate. I don't know, it's quite hard to look around and say what sort of artistically this era is going to be known as, sort of from a web design point of view or a sort of architectural point of view. It's not like you can go, well, it's brutalist.
But I would say brutalism in a web design. I mean, I don't get it. I think it's cool if you're, you know, trying to maybe prove a point for everyday use. I think it's pointless.
It's bad when people are just following something because they're not thinking. But a movement or a progression is no bad thing. It's when you just follow something, you know, you go and go, yeah, I'm going to do it this way because that's the popular thing. That's the trend. But yeah, I think there's a distinction.
But then, you know, as a trend, things start to wear off and it's not always helpful or beneficial to the end goal. And I think that's just maturity of a designer. Is the more you do it, it's really thinking about, this isn't my ego, this isn't my portfolio, this is for the person that has hired me to get them a desired result, to solve their problems. What is actually the best answer here?
And there's a whole bunch of things that contribute to, you know, everything looking the bloody same. And I'm not just talking about flat design and whether your buttons are round or sharp or glossy or flat or whatever. I'm talking about layout, typography. I'm talking about, you know, the fundamentals of design. Most of the people that are actually producing something which is visual that you see on a screen have not been taught design.
Graphic design inspiration that I always go back to is land design. They use like symbolisms and things that used to be like a very, very like ancient and, you know, like from like ancient times, but bring it to life in like a really cool modern way. Another one is this agency. It's called I Love Dust. They're always kind of not following the trend, and then they're the kind of the, you know, setting the trend. Group of people, they're working for like a Nike and yeah, all the big companies as well, but you know, yet still keeping it very kind of niche and not kind of, you know, going into the mainstream commercial design, which is, yeah, quite inspiring.
I've sort of talked about him a little bit in the past, but there's Carl Gerstner. He was a magazine designer, magazine and book designer back in the 1950s, 1960s. And he did some amazing work for this magazine called Capital and came up with what looks like an incredibly complex grid layout for his pages. Actually, when you simplify it, it's not that complex. But what we want to do is we want to go, well, what was he doing? What problem was he trying to solve? And what different approach is he taking to what we're taking? That's an interesting spread. How is something that looks random created from something which looks so structured in terms of the grid? How can we do a similar thing on the web? How can we make something that feels kind of a little bit random, a little bit organic, full of energy, out of something which is essentially made of boxes and columns online? And then you take something and learn from it and then try and apply it to what we're doing. That's not copying the aesthetic, it's looking at the principles.
I'm definitely very California Pacific Coast inspired, just in my soul, which of course like comes into my design as well. But then there's another side that feels very, you know, bold and strong fonts and more of like a Nike athletic kind of inspired vibe. And with working with clients, you know, there is definitely an element where clients come to you because they like your style that you've sort of created and they see something in that that they want to emulate for their own brand.
It's like a really good opportunity to actually get weird. Like, it's kind of my first area of focus to me, you know, like getting weird, not just for sake of getting weird, but like knowing who you are, like knowing your, you know, whatever the brand that you're working with.
Digging into the core of the brand personality and basically use all these tools to convey that, like show off your personality, like brand personality in a unique way, is probably going to be a key.
I find curiosity incredibly appealing and attractive. And I think that that is a quality that I would like to see more people have.
Everyone should buy this book, Story of Art. It's where I started my love of design, Ian Gumrick. Yeah, it's brilliant.
I think it's important to like find and kind of hone that style a bit, but then, you know, how can you expand outside of it? I think there's some designers that are super successful with just sticking to one style and people come to them for that, and that's awesome. I think for me personally, I would get a little bored by that. I like the challenge of doing something a bit different, going outside my comfort zone. And there's always new trends and things popping up that I'm like, ooh, I want to test that out a little bit, see if I like that. I want to try something over there. I think it keeps me on my toes a bit.
I think curiosity is a difficult one, because sometimes curiosity doesn't take you where you think it's going to take you. And I'm fortunate in the clients that work with me kind of know what they're getting.
My obsession is constantly staying curious, and when something new comes along, not being too close-minded to it. So for me, that looks like, you know, obviously graphic design and web design and branding, and it's photography, but it's also videography, and it's also writing, and it's sales copywriting, and it's all of these things that do pique my interest. And so I try to just stay curious, stay hungry, and like stay a little bit obsessed with them all, of just how can I get a little bit better with each design? How can I push myself a little bit more and see what I can create?